views and opinions expressed in the following program are those of the hosts and guests and not necessarily those of the staff and management of WWDBTV.
Hey everybody, glad you came back this week to WTF America. As you can see, Dirk's been locked up again. We didn't have the bail money. Hopefully we'll have it in the next couple days so he can make it next week, because we have some exciting things to talk about on next week's show, and it's going to be important that Dirk's here, right?
It's going to be amazing.
Okay, amazing. Yes. Okay. Borderline spectacular.
Yes.
Okay. So then I want to say to all of you people who don't watch the show, you better continue not watching, because otherwise you won't miss this. So welcome, Bianca. How are you today?
Thank you so much. I'm a little wonky today.
I can understand that, because we've got an incredible guest today.
Yeah, we do.
We have David Schoen from the Nevada Court Watchers PAC. Is that correct?
That is correct.
So what the hell does Nevada Court Watchers PAC do? I mean, PAC's a political action committee, right?
Right.
So you do stuff to take action.
Sure.
So why don't you tell us about it?
Absolutely. So Nevada Court Watchers PAC is an organization. We're focused on eradicating corrupt and immoral organizations and people from Nevada politics.
You got your work cut out for you.
What's my position?
Yes, like in the PAC. Like
so what's... I co-founded the PAC last year, and we started it as a way to address some of the foul play that was really going on in Nevada politics. For years, Nevada politics has been influenced by these immoral and corrupt organizations that are more in it for themselves and really do nothing to help Nevada families or push a positive political landscape.
What makes Nevada any different?
God damn it! Is your main focus family court?
It's not family court. So it's the judiciary in general. So when you look at judicial officers and judicial candidates, they are nonpartisan. They really don't get into the bickering back and forth that you see in traditional politics. And they're really limited on how they can address criticism or respond in the way you would imagine a typical campaign. For example, if you look at like a Democrat versus Republican ticket, there's a lot of mudslinging back and forth. You don't see that in judicial races because they have a higher ethical threshold that they have to meet to when they run their campaign. The problem with that, though, is that a lot of organizations latch onto that and use that as a way to go after judicial candidates and target judicial races without much repercussion. So we started Nevada Court Watchers PAC as a way to keep the judiciary honest from an electoral perspective.
So, and then getting back to my question, I'm serious. I'm saying, what makes Nevada different than any other state? I mean, are you... I understand that you're doing it here because this is where you live.
Yes.
But is it your opinion or your PAC's opinion that we're better or worse than any other state, or is it pretty typical throughout the states as this
really,
is the way it works?
Just because you're here.
It's because we're here. Yeah. I mean, look, this is our home. This is where our families live. These are the courts that we have to, I mean, anything from a traffic ticket to domestic relations to the most extreme criminal matters. I mean, these are the people that we trust to make decisions regarding our lives. And so, of course, we're going to be protective and concerned over our local community. To answer your question, I'm not sure. I don't know about the statistics of other states or how other states operate.
That was just a general question I was wondering about. So,
but you spend time in district court,
yes,
and not just family court.
Right. So okay. Ours is not, we're not focused on family court. We're focused on the judiciary in general. We want to make sure that judicial candidates are, that the public is aware of the association of judicial candidates with these immoral and corrupt organizations, and that we promote good candidates who are ethical, honest, and we inform the public about candidates who are on the other side of the spectrum.
So what's Alex's what's the
our Nevada judges? I was
right.
just going to ask, are you familiar with our Nevada judges?
Yeah.
Now, the thing that I like about our Nevada judges is a website where the judicial records of all of most of the judges here in town
their
record, you know, how many times they've been overturned, what they're, you know, and stuff like that. And the thing that I like about it is that there is no judgment or opinions there. This is the facts.
Right, it's just the street facts.
These are the statistics. They've had this many cases. They've had this many overturned, which gives them this percentage of being right or wrong. But there's also statements on there that say, you know, hey, there's times when a judge may be reversed, but it's through no fault of their own.
Right.
That because of circumstances that the judge wasn't aware of, and that's what I like. It's just facts. There's no BS. There's no I like this guy, I don't like this guy, and that's to me, that's what gives the website value.
Right.
So
and does that play into any?
It does.
Your...
So I've had a lot of conversations with Alex.
So you know Alex. Okay.
Our Nevada judges, and he does fantastic work.
Yeah.
He crunches data like nobody else in the state can. You know, I've worked with him on certain cases, on how to interpret certain cases when it comes to those error rates.
Right.
And he is really dedicated to making sure that the public has as accurate of data as possible to make informed decisions. And I think that that's really the basis of our organization as well. You know, we want the public to know the facts. Facts matter. It's too easy in this age of conspiracy theories and fake news on social media to just push out a narrative that has no supporting documents behind it, and is just it confuses voters, and it leads them down a path that may not be appropriate, that may be put them in front of a, you know, say this judge is great and they have this great background or this great history, or this is going to be a great candidate for this public office, you should get rid of this this seated public official. But it's all based off of behind the scenes wheeling and dealings that just frankly doesn't belong in the judiciary. The judiciary is supposed to be, it's blind justice. It's supposed to be impartial, not biased, and not influenced from outside sources. But you have organizations within this state and individuals within this state who have made a business out of that influence, that power, it's corruption. The word corruption gets thrown around so much when it comes to the judiciary, but let's look at what corruption really is. It's behind the scenes, wheeling and dealing, favors for other people, and there are organizations who actively engage in corruption, and so we would like that to stop.
So I consider corruption basically a lack of ethics.
And that's a component of it, absolutely.
I mean, it's because if you had some ethics, you wouldn't be corrupt intentionally,
right.
Anyway. Right. And the other thing is that most people, when it comes to the judges, they have no clue who these judges are, why they should vote for them, why they shouldn't vote for them.
But do you think that, like, a judge's error rate is important?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I think it's important.
Because you were saying, basically, that, like, it could be for some other reason.
Now, when we look at error rates, and like I said, I appreciate the work Alex does, and he crunches a lot of data for what's available to him. But there are a lot of things that are not public that would really help the public for to determine those error rates and percentages. Like, for example, with our Nevada judges, the error rates are based on cases that make it that are done at the district court level that go to the Nevada Supreme Court, make it through the Nevada Supreme Court's settlement process, make it all the way through briefing, doesn't get dismissed, and actually reaches a decision by the Nevada Supreme Court. So when you look at that from a wide perspective, for example, in family court, because that seems to be the topic on a lot of people. And I'm not going to get into the – I know. But Clark County has about 70,000 new domestic cases filed every year. So family court, new case numbers.
This is just in the family
just
court.
Just in the family division.
How many?
About 70,000.
A year?
Over with – and that's split up between about – 20 judges. A lot of those are summary petitions. They're, you know, we agreed on everything. Here it is, you know. But when you look at how many...
So like, if a family or a couple or whatever decide that they don't want to proceed with whatever, does that actually, does that count as
it's a case
something
number.
Being yeah, overturned?
Right. No.
No,
so, So when we look at how many cases get filed in family court, 70,000, approximately 70,000 every year, that gets divided up between 20 judges. Judges have thousands of active cases on their docket at any given time. Those cases that make it to the Nevada Supreme Court and go through that process is a very, very, very small fraction of those cases.
Well, somebody has to appeal the case
right.
to begin with.
Right,
so
somebody also right. has to continue filing charges.
Right, right. So you have all these cases.
Which is only, 20%?
I'm not sure the exact number.
I think that it's 20%. I think that 80% of women or just victims, 80% of those people end up dropping the charges.
So we're not talking about criminal stuff. We're talking about like custody, divorce, things like that. So when you look
at those things do end up in family court.
So the criminal So when you look at temporary protective orders, those do end up in family court. When you look at criminal charges, those are going to be in justice court or for the more serious cases, those get district bound court. Over to district court. But for family court, you have thousands of cases on a judge's docket at any given time. A small percentage of those get appealed, and a very small percentage of those actually make it through the entire appellate process to decision. We have judges who are, for example, with that our Nevada judges track. We have one judge on the bench right now who has been on the bench for over 10 years, and his error rate is based on about 110 cases. And that's how many cases out of the last 10 years, and mind you, he has thousands of cases on his docket at any given time that made it through the appellate process and made it to a decision. 110 cases, that's what his error rate's based on. So it's great information for the public to understand what, you know, a sample size of how judges perform, but it's not all-encompassing of the judge's performance. And unfortunately, and I've had this conversation with Alex, that data is just not available to him. They don't publicly provide how many cases get disposed of in which way, or and that would help his organization so much more to have that information.
He says that all the time.
But I also think that he's doing a great job from an advocate's perspective of trying to let the court know that this is information that should be public and that should be presented to the voters to say, look, you know, you may have an error rate of 40%, which sounds really bad, but when you look at that over a 100-case sample out of tens of thousands of cases you've tried and that have been in front of you over a year, that's a very small, like, fraction of a percentage.
It's something. It's something that the public can see.
You're right.
Because where else can you go to find out about a judge?
I'm sorry, say it one more time.
Where else can you go to find out about a judge?
You can't really.
I mean, there's nothing. Is this judge any good? Well, how do I know?
You really have two things. You have our Nevada judges who tracks data, and like I said, I love the work they do. Alex is a fantastic advocate, and he has great plans to make sure that as his organization continues to grow, that the data becomes more accurate as he goes along and he processes it accurately, which I think is a huge.
Well, recently he got some information about a number of cases that he had there, and he made the statement on the website that you know, we received this information, we don't know, you know, whether it's true or whether it's not, but we are taking a look at it, so please.
And they are posting now, like, video.
Oh yeah,
you can watch.
Yeah,
and that's really interesting. Anyway, totally different. Well, not totally different subject, but kind of different subject. Like, how did you decide that you wanted to do this? And what kind of law are you currently working in?
So I'm an advanced certified paralegal practicing family law, but I have a wide. That's just what I do now. But I have a substantial background in everything from I started my career in the military as a JAG paralegal. I've worked everything from death penalty cases to contract and administrative law to family law to small claims. I mean, I've had a wide number of legal disciplines that I've practiced in, but currently I work family law. And
like, how bored were you when you decided that this was something that you wanted to get involved with?
I was more frustrated than anything. It wasn't about boredom, because I have, like most people, I have 100 things on my plate at any given time, and you know, but you find causes that really matter and that you want to make sure you're doing the right thing for your community, and this was one of them. So
because you're not involved in that, like, for yourself.
No,
like,
of course
not. You don't have to go to family court for your own craziness.
But that's basically what you're doing as a job.
That's why I wonder, like, why
wanted
to.
And it's important.
Involve yourself at all, like, not family court, just in general. Like, what did it for you?
Because the judiciary matters. It really does. I mean, it
more than most people realize.
More than most people realize, because when you look at it, of course, you have the governor, who is this ceremonial figurehead, who makes, who has a lot of power here in this state, because we have, on the other end of it, a legislature that only meets once every other year for a few months. But the people really making the decisions, who are interpreting this law and really molding progress in Nevada, is the judiciary. And so, watching the judiciary for so long get improperly influenced really rubbed me the wrong way.
Well, you've made that comment a couple of times about being improperly influenced. Can you clarify that a little bit?
Sure.
Tell me, what you're talking about.
So our focus for our organization right now is to address the antics of an organization called Veterans in Politics, and its leader, Steve Sansom.
Oh, okay.
Steve Sansom has been a figure in Nevada politics for quite some time.
Okay, and just for the sake of letting you know that this company used to have Steve's show here on WWDBTV.
Absolutely.
Which we got rid of a while ago, but so I just wanted to make sure you were aware of that.
Absolutely.
Okay.
So Steve Sansom has been a mark in Nevada politics for quite some time. He has, for years, his organization was the only organization that was vetting or endorsing candidates. And from a political perspective, endorsements mean a lot. You know, candidates want to be able to put on their billboard endorsed by veterans or supported by veterans, and that gives them a lot of credence with the community.
Credibility.
So Sansom really took on that role of being the go-to for veterans endorsement. The problem is it got to his head. And that mentality of we're going to help veterans issues transitioned into how's it going to help Steve Sansom. And so So you know, I was actually associated with Veterans in Politics for about 9 months back in 2014. I joined the organization. I worked with Steve. I helped put on a few events, and you know, during the time that I was with his organization, just a lot of red flags started coming up. I had no access to the books. I was listed on the Nevada Secretary of State's website as one of the directors, but I didn't have access to his financials. I didn't know where I was there helping raise money for Veterans in Politics, but I had no idea where it was going. And then in 2015, I was asked to sit on one of his endorsement panels. And I sat on the endorsement panel, and I remember it. I remember the case or the interview very vividly. It was the Henderson City Council race where then candidate or then City Councilwoman Deborah March was running for re-election. I think it was in Ward 2. I think it was Ward 2, but I may get that one wrong. And she was running against a woman who was challenging her. Her name was Crystal Hendrickson. And I remember going through the process of his endorsement interviews, and typically the way it worked then was when the interview started, he would turn on the camera. So before the interview started, cameras weren't on. So when he talks about this transparent endorsement process, there really are a lot of holes in that. Camera's not on. And I watched a few seats to the left of me, Sanson walk over and hand a piece of paper to one of the panelists. And I thought that was kind of strange. And so I just sat down. I waited to my as it went through the questions. And the question, then an individual who was on the panel opened up the piece of paper and read the question to Ms. Hendrickson. The question, it was loaded, and it was worded in a way that was clearly intended to make her fumble her answer. It had to do with whether she had changed party affiliations at one point, even though city council races are nonpartisan, right. So it shouldn't really matter. Right. But you know, she had changed her party affiliations, but it was worded in a way that made her stumble over her words. After that process of the endorsement interviews and going through the panel, when it came to deliberations, you know, Sanson again touts this whole transparent process. Okay, he records the interviews, but he kicks everyone out of the room for the endorsement interviews or for the deliberations to determine who's going to get the endorsement, and he makes everyone sign non-disclosure agreements, and so he handed non-disclosure agreements out and told everyone to sign it and return it. And I've worked in this field for a long time. I know what non-disclosure agreements are, so I didn't sign one. I took mine and quietly folded it and I stuffed it in my pocket because I wasn't going to bind myself to that.
Right.
And I watched him manipulate the endorsement process. He claims he didn't have a vote, but just in the same way that the conductor of an orchestra doesn't play an instrument, but he leads everyone along. So there's Sanson in the background just orchestrating everything, saying who, you know, that these candidates were not endorsing, you know, we really like these candidates, and guiding everyone to the people that he wanted. And so that really bothered me because it was really touted as this fair and transparent endorsement process. So I left, and it was a week or two later, I started seeing his email blasts come out. And one of those email blasts was promoting Deborah March, who received the endorsement, and rightfully so. She was a great candidate, and she's a great mayor now. But it was promoting Deborah March, and it was using the video of Crystal Hendrickson from that endorsement interview to attack Crystal Hendrickson. So he created this narrative of, I'm going to bring this candidate onto my endorsement interview. I'm gonna let her think that she has a fair process. I'm gonna give her a loaded question, and then I'm gonna use that question that video against her to campaign for my friend. And so I left the organization. I couldn't deal with it at that point. At that point, I was done. And so over the years since I left, there's been this transition of Sanson moving from more political stuff to more activism stuff, over the last few years he's been tackling or trying to.
Okay, I'm gonna say when I worked on the panels, like, that is not how it went at all.
Sure. And so, and I
not at all. Like, I just want to say that, like, that is not how it went for me.
And that's fine. And look, and I understand that. And so,
so that may have, I don't know.
And
but,
there, and there
but
may
no, but I like, when I worked on the panels, it was great. He did not, like, participate in that at all. And I think we did a really good job. But what you're saying now, that definitely, yeah, I'm 50-50. Panels.
And I love the, and I love the idea. And,
but this.
And I love and I love the idea. And to be clear, I love the idea of the endorsement panel. I don't think that's an issue. And my experience may not be everyone else's experience.
And right.
I recognize that.
I did the panel several years later, and they were great.
Right.
Like, I think that that worked really, really well.
That situation for me and from my personal experience really soured my opinion of Steve Sansom and his organization because it felt very manipulated to me.
But the reality is that was just that base layer of this grand cake of corruption that Sansom built. Go ahead and say it. I don't know. But I just, honestly, the panels that I worked on were fantastic. He had no input. And I chose a lot of people who I really respected, and they won their races, so.
And look, and I respect that. And there were a lot of candidates, and I absolutely acknowledge that there were a lot of candidates that were endorsed that day that were very deserving. I still agree that Deborah Marks was deserving of that endorsement, and I don't.
I just want to throw that out there,
and I appreciate
just because that was my experience.
But everybody's experience is different, and in my case, it was more souring than sweet.
Yeah, no, that would suck. I'm just gonna back up what I did. I think that my experience was fantastic. But
so when I left Veterans in Politics, as he started transitioning into this this role of promoting veterans issues, which he really wasn't at all to begin with. I mean, he really didn't do veterans events, or at least that I could see, because the books were never open to me. Give money to veterans causes. He started transitioning into more activism and started taking on the judiciary.
And specifically family court.
I don't understand that. And as he started pushing into this more of this, as he started moving into more of this this activism role, he started saying a lot of things that really embellished who he was and just didn't add up. A lot of questions started popping up in my head. For example, he puts on this persona that he's this grand war hero that, if you listen to him talk, he has this persuasive way of almost convincing you that he single-handedly brought down Saddam Hussein during the Gulf War. And it's the truth. That's what he says. He has said on, you mentioned that he was on this radio show, or he was on this
network.
Not this radio
not this show,
but this
same network, whatever.
Network.
Yeah.
TV show.
Internet TV show years ago. And on his show, he said, his words were, "I was a Huey Gunner."
Oh no! That was he was still over.
Oh,
at
he
the
was still
other,
on the other
he
one.
He was
okay.
still at the other. He was still over at KLAB on the. That was a radio show at
okay.
that time. Yeah.
So as
that
part
was
of,
before he came on board with us.
As part of his Veterans in Politics talk show, he said, and I'm quoting this near verbatim, that he said, "I was a Huey Gunner. I fired 50, 60 caliber machine guns out of Huey's." In the Gulf War. First of all, I don't know what a 60 caliber machine gun is. I know what a 50 cal is, but I don't know what a 60 cal is. And he said, and I'll tell you, when you put one of those striker rounds through the enemy, any part of their body is flying off. These are his words. I'm not making it up, and I have clips of them that I have shared widely. But his service record says something else. And as a veteran, my service means a lot to me. I gave I gave my time for my country, and I served my country honorably. And I don't dispute that Sanson's actual legitimate service was honorable. He left with an honorable discharge. What I take an issue with is embellishing his service record in a way that makes him sound more heroic to help boost his own ego. You know, you look at things like his DD-214, no combat action medal, no air medal, no air wings, no flight training. I mean, we have records from that are releasable under the Freedom of Information Act. These are his actual service records directly from the military that show that he has, I mean, he did spend time in the Gulf War, but he was a junior enlisted logistics clerk. I personally spoke with members that he served with. I tracked them down, and I spoke with people in his section, in his logistics section that he served with, who said he was never in combat. He was stationed in Saudi Arabia, over 100 miles away from the Iraq or Kuwait border. And Saudi Arabia is a friendly nation.
Yeah.
Basically, what he did was naval ships would come up. They would unload all the supplies.
A warehouse guy.
He was a warehouse guy. He counted, you know, boxes of ammo and knee pads. I mean, that was what he did. He didn't do anything fantastic. I mean, his service was great. Anybody who serves, and I understand that there's that, you know, from the infantrymen to the cooks, that everybody plays a role in it. But
that's absolutely correct. And they're no matter what your role, it's still important. Because for the one guy that's in combat, there are 9 people behind him supporting him.
And you are 100% correct on that.
You know, they get just as much of my respect as anybody else. So,
but what you don't,
and especially when you actually volunteer
right.
for service,
absolutely.
Right. But what I'm saying is that,
and I love that.
If you have to brag about what you did,
right,
that's a problem.
My opinion is you didn't really fucking do it. So
I have a problem. I have a huge problem with someone embellishing their service record to make themselves sound better than they actually are. You don't need to lie. You don't need to say, "I killed people," when you didn't kill people. How demented is that, right? So those red flags really started ticking or going up with me. And then when we look at his financial records. I mentioned earlier that I was part of his organization. I never saw his books. First, he claimed that Veterans in Politics was a nonprofit organization. The IRS says that it's not a nonprofit organization. This is a letter directly from the IRS that says...
Is that current?
It was, I believe, as of a year ago.
Okay.
But it says, we have no record of this organization having tax-exempt status under Internal Revenue Code Section 501A. So his organization is not a nonprofit. And beyond that, he doesn't file tax returns. For the last 12 years, he's filed 3 tax returns.
Are you saying
his organization? His organization, Veterans in Politics.
Yeah, I just wanted to clarify that.
So here's another letter from the IRS that says, when requested from 2006 through the present, and I think this was in 2018, that the only... or 2017, the only tax records they could provide were his 2009 taxes. The rest of them didn't exist. They were not filed. And then for the tax records that he did file, here is the Veterans in Politics tax return signed by Steve Sanson for 2017 and for 2018. Both show that his organization took in $0 and spent $0. He signed with the IRS, the Internal Revenue Service, that his organization made no money and spent no money during 2017 and 2018. Now, I know for a fact that that's false, because in 2018 alone, he held his annual Valentine's or biannual Valentine's Day gala, where he charged $125 per person to go sit and eat crappy food and, you know, participate in a silent auction that I don't think anyone ever won. But he took in money. And he had a radio show here with this network that either he paid for monthly.
Yeah, and he did.
He paid money for monthly. Even if it were free, that would have been an in-kind contribution that he still would have needed to report to the IRS. In either event, he's committing tax fraud. He's lying to the IRS. And so when you look at things like this, you start to question the integrity of an organization that is headed by someone who's willing to embellish their service record and willing to lie to the IRS on forms. Oh, and I'll even take this one step further. Aside from the gala and this radio show and him spending money, he has received tens of thousands of dollars from over 100 candidates, nearly 100 candidates, over the last few years. I mean, you have candidates on this list and public officials who are sitting, I mean, everywhere from sitting mayors to legislators to sitting Nevada State Supreme Court justices who claimed on their contribution and expense forms with the Nevada Secretary of State that they gave him money for some purpose as part of their campaign, whether it be advertising or his billboards or towards his gala or his events, that they cut Veterans in Politics International a check for money or paid them some way. These records are current as of the end of 2019, and you have, you know, $1,500, $1,500, $1,000, $500 in 2018. Where's it on this tax return? That money should have been reported.
Yeah, because the donating the money, there's nothing wrong with that.
Absolutely. It's not donating. So, these are expenses. So, right. So candidates are using expenses. Right. But it's either one of two things. It's right. Either you have dozens of public officials who are elected and have some of the highest ethical boundaries saying that they gave him money. Either they're lying or Steve Sansom's lying. Which
so
one's more probable?
What inspired you to look into all of this?
It was my experience with Veterans in Politics. It was watching, not getting access to the books, being a part of an organization where I was raising money for, but not knowing where it's going, and then my personal experience with the process. That's what made me do it.
I mean, I understand, but this has all been...
This is a while ago.
Well, right. This has been recently in, the RJ and...
So you look at the money that comes in to Veterans in Politics during election cycles. So I have a page and a half of contributions. So, I mean, from about halfway down this page to the bottom,
but why,
this next page. But
sorry.
This is all 2014. It was tens of thousands of dollars were given to Veterans in Politics in 2014. That was the last time Nevada had all the judicial races on one ballot because they moved everything to every 6 years.
Right.
We are 6 years later. All those,
and they're all coming up again
are
in 2020.
All on the ballot again.
Right.
This.
What do you mean? Like, why? Why is this like resurfacing?
Because if you are a nonprofit organization and you're filing.
Oh no,
tax,
I fully understand.
No.
So I think
receiving,
I get it.
He's receiving income that he's not.
Right.
Declaring.
So
you're asking why it's coming up now.
Yes.
Okay. So I can answer that.
Right.
Gotcha.
Judicial. Judicial election years are his money-making years.
Mm-hmm.
2014, he made a ton of cash, and that's reported right from the candidates directly on these contribution and expense reports. 2020 is the next time where all those races are going to be back on the ballot. It's hunting season for him. So to answer your question, the reason why our organization is now addressing this issue, and it didn't address it 2 years ago, is because candidates weren't running for election 2 years ago. Our focus isn't going after Steve Sansom or Veterans in Politics. That's not what we're doing. Our goal is to let candidates know the truth about Steve Sansom, who he really is, what his organization really does and doesn't do, and let them make informed decisions on whether they want to seek his endorsement, give him money, participate in any of his programs, and further legitimize his corrupt organization, his fraudulent organization. And for us, any candidate who decides, after knowing that he lies on his taxes, that he's embellished his service record, that he has a sordid history of severe domestic violence against his spouse, including throwing his pregnant wife into a military-style safe to the point where her placenta partially detached from her uterus and wasn't getting oxygen.
Is this a police report?
This is a declaration from his ex-wife, where he says, or where she says in a sworn declaration, when I was pregnant with my daughter, Samson threw me against a military-style safe in the bedroom. I began to suffer severe pains, and I pleaded with him to take me to the hospital. He would not at the beginning, but when I began to pass blood, he finally did. The doctor said that the placenta had disconnected in such a fashion that sufficient oxygen was not getting to the fetus, and I was required to get ultrasound twice a week until the child was born. She also reports significant headbutting. In this circumstance, when he picked me up, he threw me into the car, started headbutting me. When he got home, he punched me in the stomach. I called 911. He threatened to kill me if I told the police the truth. This is somebody who is, for a long time, has been sought after in Nevada politics as someone you can go to for a legitimate endorsement. But candidates need to know that this is not the kind of person that they want.
Okay, so what was the outcome of that particular case?
Is that a police report?
So this is a sworn affidavit that led to these are criminal charges that were filed against Steve Samson, the people of the state of California versus Steve William Samson, for spousal corporal injury to the spouse, assault and battery. And in this case, I'm not exactly sure of the outcome of these criminal proceedings, but this was pulled directly from his divorce file from California. And it resulted in a temporary protective order, additional charges. You have handwritten sworn affidavits and talking about this type of violence. But this is his history. And it continues today. I mean, how many times has he gotten mad at someone and rather than saying, look, I disagree with you, he says, let's take it to the MMA ring. Let's go fight.
I know.
This 100% disabled veteran is, rather than addressing things civilly and doing it the right way.
But my understanding is that the 100% disability is mental. Traumatic brain injury, right? Isn't that what he...
He testified in 2015 in front of the Assembly... Judiciary Committee that he has fatigue and migraines from Gulf War Syndrome. Now, Gulf War Syndrome, this goes down another rabbit hole, but Gulf War Syndrome is a...
Right, because that's never actually been, like...
Gulf War Syndrome is the catch-all from, you know...
I'm not saying PTSD. It has been treated as not.
What Gulf War Syndrome is, it's not PTSD. Okay. What it is it's saying that because of the burning oil fields in Kuwait and because of the chemical warfare that Saddam Hussein used in Kuwait and Iraq, that people who come back have illnesses that are undiagnosable under another category.
Gotcha. Right. Okay. I think that's for sure a thing.
No, it is.
Right.
It is. But tell me something.
But they won't admit that that is a thing. Basically what.
But tell me something. How fatigue and migraines absolutely happens. I don't doubt that that Gulf War Syndrome is real. I'm not knocking any veteran who has legitimate illnesses. But remember, this is a guy who was over 100 miles away from combat. From these burning oil fields at a logistics depot, and members of his own unit who actually got on the helicopters and flew the supplies into combat aren't reporting these.
And that was going to be my question. Who else in his outfit have similar?
The conversations that I've had with multiple people that he served with, that nobody has a rating from. That nobody from his section has a rating higher than 50%. Now, the VA does things a little different than a lot of organizations do, like Social Security does when it comes to disability. VA will rate you at a percentage, and then if you convince them that you're unemployable because of your condition, like you can have migraines and be rated at 50%, but if you convince them that those migraines are so severe that you can't hold a job, they will pay you at 100% and consider you 100% disabled. I don't know if that's necessarily the case with Samson, but I don't know of a rating with the VA that gives you 100% disability for migraines and fatigue.
No.
And so there are a lot of questions. This conversation are the types of red flags that I've experienced over the years with Samson and his organization, and that I sought out to find the proof for. And so my background, I research. I know where to look for things. I know how to do FOIA requests. I know how to do, this is what I do. And so when I look at things like this and candidates for public office swooning over this guy because they want a veteran's endorsement and they deal with him because of it, that's a problem.
Well, it and a lot of people jump on the veterans bandwagon.
Yeah.
Which kind of pisses me off.
Absolutely.
Is that I'm doing this for the veterans.
And I'll tell you, there are legitimate veterans organizations here in Nevada who do support candidates, so candidates can still go and say supported by veterans on their on their signs. And one organization, Nevada Veterans Association, the real Nevada Veterans Association, not the one that Stanson claimed the other day that he hijacked.
What?
Yeah, he claimed that it went delinquent with the Secretary of State, so he went and refiled for the name. And now is claiming that he owns Nevada Veterans Association, even though it's copyrighted and there's a ton of other issues with it. But it's not about legitimizing, and that's a good proof. That's proof. It's not about legitimizing veterans' issues, because as a veteran, you can say, look, I support veterans, you support veterans, we have our different organizations, we all have the same goal, one team, one fight. That's just how it is, right? But that's not with Sanson. Sanson wants to monopolize the veteran community here. If anybody comes out against him, Nevada Veterans Association started, he went after Richard Carrion, the then president of Nevada Veterans Association, solely because it was competition for him.
Sure.
It ate away at his business. And that's exactly what veterans in politics is. It's a business. So when you look at somebody who has such a sordid history, who embellishes his service record, who lies to the IRS, who has a severe history of domestic violence and threatening violence recently on people. He's even threatened violence on me on multiple occasions.
I was going to say, is Steve aware of any of the stuff that you're doing
Absolutely.
Here?
Absolutely. Okay. And you know what? It's funny because we're not telling the public about Sanson. We're telling the candidates about Sanson because they're the ones who fund his enterprise.
Gotcha.
They're the ones who put him on the
soapbox
that he stands on.
Well, unfortunately, you are now telling the public.
Now I am. But our focus is not to the public. Our focus is to inform the candidates. This is who you are associating with. You can go, if you want a veteran's endorsement or a veteran's support, go to a legitimate organization. But if you decide to go with this organization, knowing how corrupt it is, then I don't think you're in a position to sit on the bench.
Right.
So now we're going to target your campaign. And
that's
our goal.
So we have a double-edged sword here.
Yes.
In a sense. And that is that just as the public doesn't know much about judges or candidates or whatever the political...
Right, samesies.
Right, like, yeah. So I mean, in general, unless you're at the top of the ticket, the average person really doesn't know who the hell you are, your record, or anything like that. But I think that also works the other way.
Right,
how many of those people know about organizations that they are seeking support from? You follow me?
Yeah.
Oh, completely.
So I understand what you're saying.
So it's like it doesn't really make any sense to tell somebody that if they show up to a panel or something that they are delegitimized. Like,
right.
So I'll break it down in a little different perspective. You have candidate Joe Smith for district court judge.
Right.
We tell him Steve Sanson has battered his spouse, lies on his taxes, embellished his service record, actually has orders from sitting district court judges spelling out how corrupt he is and how he tried to personally influence the decision on a case.
Can I ask what that case is?
Sure. It's the case of Anzel versus Anzel. It was a divorce case.
Oh, okay.
And this is where...
That's not the one I was thinking of then.
Steve Sanson called district court judge Bryce Duckworth on his personal cell phone to try to influence him on his decision in this case. And we talked about our Nevada judges.
We know about this.
So we talked about our Nevada judges. Judge Duckworth is one of the top rated judges on the Judging the Judges poll year after year, or every time they do it, he's one of the top-rated judges on the bench. He's been the presiding family court judge for quite some time. And he has the second lowest percentage error rate of any judge on family court here in Clark County. So he is a good judge.
Yeah.
By data and all accounts, your opinion on specific cases is different, but the data shows that he's an ethical judge. This is what he said in this written order. Is there anything more corrupt than the influence Mr. Sanson sought to exert over this court? And he proclaims that he seeks to expose corruption because this court called him out on the inappropriateness of his communication and refused to kowtow and cower to his manipulation and control. Mr. Sanson predictably let the court know that his wrath was coming out against this court. This type of threat to any judicial officer strikes at the very core of the integrity of the judicial process. Moreover, such threatening behavior is an attempt to manipulate and control judicial officers if they do not succumb to Mr. Sanson's desired result.
That's some pretty strong language.
We know this
right.
story.
Yeah.
So we tell judges, we tell candidates, this is who you're seeking an endorsement from. If Judge Joe Smith or candidate Joe Smith wants to run for that department and we tell him this and we inform him and he says, I want the veterans in politics endorsement anyways. I question your.
But did he even read it? Like,
it's likely not. Look,
and
I have reached out to multiple campaign managers. We are making an effort to with the candidates directly to spread this as widely as possible and to make them know the facts of who Sanson really is. And let them make the decision on their own. But if they, so I'll give you an.
Oh, I'm not telling you, like, don't tell everybody.
Sure.
No, not at all. Like, no, like no, whatever. No. You do you, and you're probably doing something cool. But you can't think that all of the candidates are going to, like, to read something.
Absolutely, I can't. And I'll tell you why. Because if you are running for office, for public office, it's your responsibility. You're responsible for
your
own campaign.
It would be lovely if they did, so, but they're probably not going to read everything that we all send them.
So,
wait. But if there is a red flag somewhere, or someone brings up a red flag, it behooves you to do a little investigation.
Sure, but like
you can tell your campaign manager.
I don't read all of my mail, and I'm not doing anything.
Our emails.
But if you get an envelope with a big red stripe across it that says disconnect notice or something like that,
and you don't
read it, you're probably going to open it and look at it.
But at the end of it, you're responsible.
I'm probably not, if I'm honest. Like, I'm probably not.
We have sent.
Then it's a good thing you're not running.
Yes, sir.
We have sent all of our emails regarding Sanson with all of this information and veterans in politics to the candidates, to their campaign managers, to the press. Hence, we've gotten some traction.
So basically,
we're trying to let the candidates know.
Right.
This is who you're associating with. And if you decide to, after knowing this and being informed or having the information available to you, you decide to still participate in that process or to further legitimize Sanson or his faux organization, then I question your ability to sit on the bench. Your qualifications for sitting on the bench. You have some serious moral and ethical concerns, and we are going to campaign against your candidacy. So a candidate who Joe Smith wants to run for judge decides to go, he sees our emails, we send them to them, or whether he opens them or not, if we tell him and we give him the information to do it and he decides to go sit on that endorsement interview, we are going to target his candidacy. We are going to go campaign against him. And it's absolutely our right to do so. This is a political,
sure.
is a political arena.
I mean, that's honestly, I think that's a little wacky.
Okay.
I don't know. Like, how could you campaign against somebody just because they showed up somewhere? Like, their opponent might be awful.
Wait.
So listen. Like,
so, and this is an extreme example. But would you endorse a candidate who attended a KKK rally?
That's pretty different.
No, I'm like, saying it's a, it is like, an,
no,
it's an
I
extreme,
sure would not.
It's,
like,
a, it's an extreme example, but it's still it's a matter of degrees.
And like I like if you're running, like you know what the KKK is,
right?
You very well might have no idea what veterans in politics.
But that's our goal. So we're not.
That's
we're,
what
we're
he's
not,
saying. His
so,
job
so
is
no,
if I'm
not,
if I'm interpreting that correctly.
Correct. We,
you're
we
saying
are not,
we're letting these people know. And if you still continue, or if you still want to do that after we've told you this is a KKK meeting,
right?
We're going to go against you.
No, and I understand. I understand your concern on this. So look, we're not going after candidates who previously associated with Steve Sansom. We are setting a baseline, saying from this date forward, once we inform you, if you continue to do so, you are now subject to negative campaign against you. And look, that's politics. There are positive campaigns, there are negative campaigns. The whole idea is to push a desired result. It's a protected First Amendment right to be able to campaign how you feel to do so. Now, as a judge, as somebody who is supposed to sit on the bench and have the highest ethical standards personally, and to have to follow this giant code of judicial conduct and to be as fair and impartial as possible, to know and to actively seek the support of somebody who has done this slew of things, all these things, that makes me question your ability to be fair and impartial.
Your judgment.
Your judgment.
I think I did a great job with endorsements the last time they had me do endorsements. Who knows if they're going to have me do it at all, again? Probably not.
I would doubt that, seriously.
So, probably not. However, 2016, Brandon and I wrote the Libertarian Voters Guide, and I am not a libertarian, but I think I did a damn good job. Brandon and I like wrote it up like bitchy queens because we're bitchy queens, but I'll tell you this. I was able to like focus on what I was actually supposed to do. I'm not a libertarian, but I get what they want.
And so I'm not attacking individual panel members for that. I'm not saying that anybody who like that you sitting on the panel and helping part of that endorsement that you're part of that there's a lot of information about Steve Sansom that people don't know. I mean, I'm
totally cool with like getting that out there, but he doesn't like when I did the panel. He had absolutely no say.
It's not just the panel.
One thing had nothing to do with the other.
Okay. It's not just the panel.
One of these things is not like the other.
All right, so we have about 2 minutes. We got about 2 minutes.
No, I love what you're doing. I'm super into this, but I don't think that like that somebody being endorsed by something shitty.
You can't. What he's saying is if you seek that endorsement.
It's about legitimizing veterans in politics. Veterans in Politics is a fraudulent organization that scams the IRS to line Steve Sansom's pocket, run by an individual who has no moral compass whatsoever, and who thinks that he is in control enough of judges to try to influence their decision on cases.
And
that is so. Okay. So the people who put him on that soapbox to make him feel like he was strong enough to call Judge Duckworth and say, "Hey, why aren't you giving me the result that I want?"
Oh man, that was a mess.
So the people who put him on that soapbox are the politicians, the judges, the candidates who have given him tens of thousands of dollars.
This is a totally different thing, and I get that.
Anything that legitimizes his organization, anyone who legitimizes his organization, I question. I don't care from what perspective, whether it's attending a radio show. Radio show, people listen onto it because the candidate's on there, and you may have a high-level candidate. You legitimize who he is. You go to his endorsement interviews, you say, this is a legitimate veterans endorsement. And that my support from that I am supported by veterans in politics, and the reality is that it has nothing to do with veterans. It has nothing to
why are you seeking an endorsement from
an organization that isn't supported? That why are you saying why should candidates be permitted to say endorsed by veterans on their
A lot of thing. Them actually because, don't
Because
even.
They do. Because
a lot of them do.
Because
a lot of them don't.
Of their endorsement from Veterans in Politics, which does nothing for the veteran community.
All right, so we got to wrap this up. I'm sorry, we got another show
absolutely.
Starting. So I'm going to give you one more minute to finalize anything that you want to say. Look into the camera, tell people whatever you want to tell them. I just want to thank the First Amendment.
Yes, absolutely. And thank you for the opportunity to be here on WTF America.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you. Our organization is Nevada Court Watchers PAC. You can visit our website, ncwpac.org. And also follow us on Facebook. Our goal is really just to make sure that we have candidates and judges who end up sitting on the bench who have a moral understanding of what it takes to be fair and impartial and not influenced by outside corrupt organizations.
Thank you.
As a candidate, if you decide that you want support from a veterans organization, I highly encourage you to reach out to Nevada Veterans Association and their president, Donna Lee, Nevada Veterans Coalition. There are a couple other ones out there, but there are legitimate organizations that you can still get support for your campaign materials, for your billboards, say supported by veterans, but you're not giving money, you're not giving time or legitimacy to a corrupt organization.
Okay. Thank you, David.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Thanks again for all of...
Thanks for not watching.
Yeah, thanks for the people who watched, and thank you all who didn't. We're going to close with...
Don't be a dick.
Everybody knows that the dice are loaded. Everybody rolls with their fingers crossed. Everybody knows the war is over. Everybody knows the good guys lost. Everybody knows the fight was fixed. The poor stay poor, the rich get rich. That's how it goes. Everybody knows. Everybody knows that the boat is leaking. Everybody knows the captain lied. Everybody got this broken feeling, like their father or their dog just died. Everybody talking to their pockets. Everybody wants a box of chocolates and a long stem rose. Everybody knows. Everybody knows that you love me, baby. Everybody knows that you really do. Everybody knows that you've been faithful, give or take a night or two. Everybody knows you've been discreet, but there were so many people you just had to meet without your clothes. And everybody knows. Everybody knows. Everybody knows. That's how it goes. Everybody knows. Everybody knows that's how it goes. Everybody knows. And everybody knows that it's now or never. Everybody knows that it's me or you. And everybody knows that you live forever. Oh, when you've done a line or two. Everybody knows the deal is rotten. Old Black Joe still picking cotton for your ribbons and bows.
and everybody knows. And everybody knows that the plague is coming. Everybody knows that it's moving fast. Everybody knows that the naked man and woman are just a shining artifact of the past. Everybody knows the scene is dead, but there's gonna be a meter on your bed that will disclose what everybody knows. And everybody knows that you're in trouble. Everybody knows what you've been through. From the bloody cross on top of Calvary to the beach in Malibu. Everybody knows it's coming upon. Take one last look at this sacred heart before it blows. And everybody knows. Everybody knows. Everybody knows. That's how it goes. Everybody knows. Everybody knows. Everybody knows. That's how it goes.